Blackstone Audio presents Jump the Gun, an Annabelle Starkey mystery by Zoe Burke. Narrated by Hilary Huber. For Thomas, my leading man. Chapter 1. I love movies. They're my passion, my great escape. Oh, sure, my life is okay. Decent job, loving parents, friends. But I've always been the Joan Cusack character in Working Girl, playing the good sport and faithful sidekick, while the leading lady Melanie Griffith lands the great job, the great man, the great life. I'm 32 and pretty enough, if you ignore my big ears, and smart enough, but all I've ever landed was on my feet. Dull guys wanted to move in. Exciting guys wanted to move on. I couldn't seem to find my own perfect leading man. When I met Mickey 3 weeks ago in Chicago at a national book convention, I liked him right away. He had Al Pacino eyes and a smile as crooked as Ellen Barkin's. And I don't know if you ever saw the movie, but when I looked at him, I felt like I was smack dab in the middle of Sea of Love. It's one of my all-time favorites, full of hot sex and edge-of-your-seat danger. And I had a sudden urge to meet him in a grocery store wearing nothing but a raincoat. You have to see the movie, one of Pacino's top three. On Sunday, during the final long hours of the convention, we were each taking a break. I was sipping coffee, standing up at one of those tall, chairless tables common at convention centers. Mickey had perched his sunglasses on his forehead and was talking on his cell phone when he noticed me. I smiled. He fixed his gaze on me while he finished his call, then snapped his phone shut and held out his hand. Mickey Paxton. Annabelle Starkey. He held my hand a little bit longer than a handshake, and when he let it go, he said, "Wow." "Wow? Does that line usually work for you?" He laughed. "Don't know. Never used it before." "Try another one." I was still smiling. "How about I tell you that I'm 40 and I live in New York and I'm a sales director?" "Whoa," I interrupted. "How about instead we start with your favorite movie?" He frowned. Not sure. I guess The Year of Living Dangerously." Now I laughed. "Is that a warning?" "I hope not." He leaned toward me on the table. "I'd like to take you to Las Vegas with me, tomorrow morning." I set my coffee cup down and raised my eyebrows. You think I'm an easy pickup?" He took a step back. "Oh, look, no. I'm sorry. That's not it at all. I'm not. Buy me a drink first, before we get dangerous." He smiled, that crooked smile. "You bet." We met that evening by the river at a quiet upscale bar, one with overstuffed leather chairs and floor-to-ceiling windows. Mickey arrived first. He was waiting outside in front, on his phone again.
"Got it. Looks like it will all be wrapped up tomorrow. They can handle the rest here."
Pause. He winked at me.
"Roger that. I'll stay under."
He dropped the phone in his pocket and put his hand on my shoulder.
"Glad you're here."
"You're under?" I asked.
"What?"
"I heard you say that you'll stay under." He put his hand back in his pocket.
"Oh, that. Yeah, I'm under the gun, so to speak, to make sure some deals go through. You know, sales."
I did know. I was the publicity manager for a San Francisco publisher of How to Live Your Life and Here's What You Should Think books. But before I could ask him more about these deals, he smiled and directed me to the door, his hand on my back.
"You look wonderful."
We walked into the bar. By the time we finished that first drink, I was a goner. This man was not only gorgeous, piercing brown eyes, thick dark hair, that mischievous smile. He knew how to listen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.